Welcome to Epiphany, the season of illumination where we announce God's light as revealed and radiated throughout all of creation. Epiphany traditionally falls on January 6th, the 12th day after Christmas. But we do so, the closest time for this, and on Sunday, you usually celebrate on the second Sunday after Christmas. As we do, we end our Christmas celebrations and begin the season of Epiphany. The word Epiphany means to reveal or make known. And in the season, we focus on how God revealed God's self in human flesh as Jesus. It is fitting that we have a reading from the Gospel of Matthew, the journey of the wise men or magi who come from the east to offer their gifts to the Christ child. Well, when I was little, when I was a boy, I always wanted to be one of the wise men, and they were my favorite characters in the Christmas story, other than Jesus, of course. Whenever the children would put on a Christmas pageant, I wanted to be one of the wise men. I really enjoyed dressing up like a wise man and wearing a crown. I think they're the coolest characters in the story. And then I would walk up to the manger and kneel before the baby Jesus, and I would pull out my treasure, and I would give that great gift to Jesus, the King of Kings. There is something about this story that is intriguing and captivating. There is something about these characters which attracts us. So who are these people? We usually call them wise men or kings. The word that appears in the original Greek is magoi. That is where we get the word magi. And the word literally means a magician, or it can be also used as an astrologer. Some magi were religious leaders, and some of the magics that they practiced were close to what we call the natural sciences than it was to magic. And they were well known for their observations of nature and for the wisdom they gained from the observing nature. And so these were probably indeed wise people and who had studied the writings of many religions and were aware of the world around them. So it is no surprise that they would notice that a new star had appeared in the sky and would understand its significance. They were probably also men, in this case, of power and wealth, and they may not have actually ruled over kingdoms, but magi were often employed by kings. And then one ancient writing said that the Persian could not become a king until he had mastered the sciences of the magi. So they would have had the positions in royal courts and were probably well paid for their services. And where did they come from? And all the Bible says is that they came from the east. However, many believe that Isaiah was foretelling these kings' arrival when he said in Isaiah, "The multitude of camels shall go cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah, and all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord." Chapter 60, verse 6. We don't know exactly where they're from, pretty far away. The Bible doesn't even actually say how many were there. Some ancient tradition says that there were actually 12. What is clear is that they had come from foreign lands in a day when the long distance travel was not so easy to do. So, who are these wise men? They are wise, learned, wealthy men who could see the darkness of the world around them. Since they were observant and aware of the darkness, they were able to detect a new light when it appeared in the world. The many, many who were right in the same town where Jesus was born missed it. But because the Magi were observant, they saw his star from the east, and its light brought them hope. They were also from a distant land, and they were not Jews, and yet they came a long distance to pay homage for the newborn king of the Jews. Most importantly, they were the first Gentiles to worship Christ. They are a sign to us, to the world, that it was a part of God's plan to call all the world to worship Christ. And the star they followed showed us that Christ was the light sent into the world that would call all nations to himself. And just as that star called those foreigners to come to worship at the manger, as so Christ would call the whole world to kneel with them. And they represent all those Gentiles who would find redemption through Christ. The interesting fact is that the only Matthew talks about Magi. So then what was the Matthew's intention to include them in the story? What was important? It was important to Matthew to emphasize the kingship of Jesus. Do you see the first chapter of Matthew? What do you find? A long list of genealogy of Jesus. Why? Well, Matthew wanted to make sure that everyone understood from the beginning that Jesus is the direct descendant of King David. It was an implicit message of Jesus as the promised Messiah, the next King David. Therefore, Matthew went out of the way to address the genealogy of Jesus right from the beginning and indicate Jesus as the Messiah to save God's chosen people. But why then Magi? They were not Jews nor the believers of God. Why did Matthew bring these outsiders into the story? Well, I think it is to hint or suggest that the people of God are not just limited to the Jews nor to the Jewish religious faith. God is much greater than what they had believed one to be. When the new star appeared to those who studied astrology, and it was another way of God's announcement to the world outside of the Jewish world that the Savior has also come for people outside of the Jewish religious community. The author of the Working Preacher's Commentary says the following: Isaiah reminds the community of its call to be a light to the nation and destroys the false dichotomy between internal and external ministry by suggesting that expansion and restoration are integrally connected. The author of Ephesians chapter 3, in chapter 3, suggests that the ultimate purpose of God is the unification of humanity in a truly multicultural community where all distinctions between insiders and outsiders have vanished. The Gospel of Matthew reminds us that the such distinction began to change with the coming of the Christ, who was revealed to some who were thought to be on the outside and paradoxically rejected by many who were thought to be on the inside. The church's observations of the Epiphany ought not to be a triumphal occasion for those who have seen the light to celebrate their privileged status. The lesson appoints appointed to for this today, the encourage humble admission that God's glory may be manifested where we least expect it. Sometimes God's people become light for others. Sometimes they appear blind to the light others can see, but always the light is there as God graciously and mysteriously and defiantly breaks into human lives. So who are these wise men? We are. In a very real sense, all who have found salvation in Christ are represented by these wise men. Like them, we have seen the darkness of our lives. Like them, we have looked to heaven for hope. And then like them, the light of Christ has shined in our lives and given us hope. Like them, we have sought out and found the one born the King of the Jews. The same light which called those magi to worship Christ calls us to do the same. Perhaps the only way we can fully appreciate who these wise men were would be to stand in their place. And maybe we should dust off those cardboard and the tin can, tin-foiled crowns from our childhood, and the imaginations that go with them. And like those kings, take on a journey of faith and seek, find, and worship the baby Jesus asleep in the manger. Oh, that would be a long journey for some of us to travel from a darkness of our disbelief to follow the light of a child's faith. But maybe then we can begin to understand the journey that these wise men made from the darkness of the distant lands to the light of the Christ, light of Christ. Then when we arrive at the manger, we can each present the most precious treasure we could give to Christ, and we could lay our hearts on the altar as a gift to the one who came to save us. As we begin a new year, I wonder what kind of journey it would be. The world is pulling us to different directions, and we might face many unforeseen obstacles, but it is my prayer that we may embark on the journey of faith as did Magi by following the star. Thus, we may put Christ as the center of our heart. Amen.